Hare Krishna. So today we are reading Srimad Bhagavad Gita as it is, chapter 11, the universal form, text 37. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Kasmacha tena nameran mahatman. Gariyase brahmano pyadikartre. Ananta devesha jagan nivasa. Tvamaksharam sadasattat param yat. Kasmaccha tena nareman. Word by word. Okay. Kasmaccha tena Nare Nameran Mahatman Gariyase Brahmano Apya Adikartre Ananta Devesha Jagan Nivasa Tvamaksharam Sat Asat Tat Param Yat. Now we can recite. Kasmaccha tena nameran mahatman. Gariyase brahmano pyadikartre. Ananta devesha jagan nivasa. Tvamaksharam sadasattat param yat. Can someone recite? Kasmaccha tena nameran mahatman. Gariyase brahmano pyadikartre. Ananta devesha jagan nivasa. Tvamaksharam sadasattat param yat. Anyone else would like to recite? Kasmaccha tena nameran mahatman. Gariyase brahmano pyadikartre. Ananta devesha jagan nivasa. Tvamaksharam sadasattat param yat. Kasmaccha tena nareman meran mahatman. Gariyase brahmano pyadikartre. Ananta devesha jagan nivasa. Tvamaksharam sadasattat param yat. Word by word translation. Kasmat, why, cha, also, te, unto you, na, not, nameran, they should offer proper obeisances, Mahatman, O great one, Gariyase, who are better, Brahmana, than Brahma, Api, although, Adikartre, to the Supreme Creator, Anant, O unlimited, Devesh, O God of the Gods, Jagannivasa, O refuse of the universe, Tvam, you are, Aksharam, imperishable, Sat Asat, to cause and effect, Tat Param, transcendental, Yat, because. Translation and purport by His Divine Grace Srila Prabhupada. Translation. O great one, greater than even than Brahma, you are the original creator. Why then should they not offer their respectful obeisances unto you? O limitless one, God of gods, refuse of the universe, you are the invincible source, the cause of all causes, transcendental to this material manifestation. Purport. By this offering of obeisances, Arjuna indicates that Krishna is worshipable by everyone. He is all-pervading and He is the soul of every soul. Arjuna is addressing Krishna as Mahatma, which means that He is most magnanimous and unlimited. Ananta indicates that there is nothing which is not covered by the influence and energy of the Supreme Lord. And Devesh means that He is the controller of all demigods and is above them all. He is the shelter of the whole universe. Arjuna also thought that it was fitting that all the perfect living entities and powerful demigods offer their respectful obeisances unto Him, because no one is greater than Him. Arjuna especially mentions that Krishna is greater than Brahma because Brahma is created by Him. Brahma is born out of the lotus stem grown from the navel abdomen of Garbhodakshayi Vishnu, who is Krishna's plenary expansion. Therefore, Brahma and Lord Shiva, who is born of Brahma, and all other demigods must offer their respectful obeisances. It is stated in Srimad Bhagavatam that the Lord is respected by Lord Shiva and Brahma and similar other demigods. The word Aksharam is very significant because this material creation is subject to destruction. But the Lord is above this material creation. He is the cause of all causes. And being so, He is superior to all the conditioned souls within this material nature as well as the material cosmic manifestation itself. He is therefore the All Great Supreme. Let us chant Mangalacharan prayers. Om Ajnana Timirandhasya Jnana Anjana Shalakaya Chakshur Unmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Mano Bhishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamahayam Dadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yuta Padakamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamsya Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagan Raghunatham Vitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padan सहगण ललिता श्री विशाखान्वितांश्च हे कृष्ण करुणा सिंधु दीनबंधु जगतपते गोपेश गोपिका कांत राधा कांत नमोस्तुते तप्त कांचन गौरांगी राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी वृषभानुसुते देवी प्रणमामि हरि प्रिये वांचा कल्पतरुभ्यस्य कृपा सिंधुभ्यैव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः नमो विष्णुपादाय कृष्णपृष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदांत स्वामीति नामिने नमस्ते सरस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देशतारिणे जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासदि गौर भक्त वृंद हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे। So here in this chapter entitled The Universal Form, in the beginning Arjuna requests Krishna to show his universal form by which he enters into this universe, because Krishna has told Arjuna in previous chapters that he is present everywhere, he is all pervading. So someone who is present everywhere, how does his form look like? This is a question which some people may get. Though Arjuna has no doubt, he knows Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, but he knows that there are many people who may not accept Krishna as the Supreme Person. Rather, they may like to see this opulent form of Krishna, this universal form, and then they say, yes, this is God. The simple two-handed form of Radha Shyam Sundar, they may not accept as the Supreme Form or the topmost form. That form is only worshipped by devotees. Only those who have received the mercy of devotees, have come in contact with devotees, are able to appreciate this simple two-handed form, which is very easy to reciprocate with. Because devotees, they are attracted to this form because in this form, they can have a relationship with Krishna. Nobody can have a relationship with the universal form of Krishna. It's so frightening. So frightening. Devotees, what they want? They want a relationship. Our whole devotional service, the whole philosophy, the whole understanding is based on three things. Sambandha, Avideya and Prayojan. First, understanding our relationship with Krishna. Then following the process to establish that relationship, and then ultimately the achievement of the divine love. But this sambandha gyan is very difficult. It will not take place with the universal form of the Lord. But that form does create a sense of awe and reverence. So this is God, very big, very huge, and people can see the whole universe is coming out from that form, entering into that form, so they can understand, yes, this is God, this is God. That is one level of understanding which many people have, especially those who are atheists or Sometimes even Mayavadis also may be attracted to that form. So for that purpose, Arjuna requests Krishna to display that form, and Krishna is obliged by the request of his dear friend, and he agrees to show that form. But he tells that with your current eyes you will not be able to see, so I will give you divine eyes. So he bestows Arjuna with some divine eyes with which he can behold this universal form, which is so frightening and fearful, fearsome. So Arjuna requests, but after seeing this form, he becomes very frightened. And also, a mood of reverence, awe, and that all starts to develop. And then Krishna speaks to Arjuna about what all he can see there. He tells that you can see all your friends, your brothers, all the Duryodhan and the sons of Dhritarashtra, the Bhishma Dev, Dronacharya, Karna, all of them entering into my mouth. They are already dying, they are already dead. Arjuna can see all that in that form. After seeing all this, then Arjuna starts to offer some prayers. And it starts from verse number 36 to 46, 11 verses. He offers prayers to this universal form. In the last verse, he says that, O master of the senses, the world becomes joyful upon hearing your name, and thus everyone becomes attached to you. Although the perfected beings offer you their respectful homage, the demons are afraid and they flee here and there. All this is rightly done. So Arjuna is offering, glorifying Krishna and saying that all the great personalities, those who are devotees, Siddha Sangha, that is the word that has come. Siddha Sangha, the perfected beings, all those who have attained perfection, they glorify you. All the great personalities glorify Krishna. In all the three worlds, everywhere Krishna is glorified by all the great personalities. Only those who are demons or have demoniac tendencies, only they do not glorify. For a number of reasons. Number one, they don't know. They are in ignorance. They do not know who is Krishna. And some are there who know, but they are so arrogant, they still do not want to glorify. Either they have a tendency that they themselves want to become God or compete with God, or just enviousness is there. That's why they don't glorify. Others, they just do not know. That's why they don't glorify. But those who know and are devotees, are very advanced in their consciousness, they all glorify. They all glorify. So here, in this verse today, Arjuna is saying that, O great one, greater even than Brahma, that's the second line. First, kasmat te Kasma chatena nameran mahatman. Why then should they not offer their respectful obeisances unto you? Arjuna is asking, why will they not offer? Those who are perfected beings, why will they not offer? It's very natural, there is nothing so great about it. Even in this world, we see if someone does great job, people glorify, right? Now we see the Prime Minister of India is doing something good, At least he has all the good intentions. He wants to take the country forward. And so many people glorify. Many people glorify, right? So that quality of a great person attracts glorification automatically. Automatically. Those who have good nature, they appreciate, yes, this person is doing something nice. So even in this world we see, if someone comes and does some good work, many people do some charitable work, and other people glorify. So even in this world we see that if someone does something good for others, or has some greatness, some opulence, he is glorified. So why Krishna will not be glorified? He has everything. And he only does good to everyone. So there is nothing surprising. He's saying, why should they not glorify? It's very normal, it's natural to glorify Krishna. Our most natural state is to glorify Krishna. If someone is in pure state of consciousness, it means he will glorify Krishna. And then Arjuna is telling, why one should glorify? Gariyase Brahmano Api. Gariyase means greater than Brahma. Krishna is even greater than Brahma. So why he should not be glorified? So Brahma is someone who has created this universe. But Krishna is even the creator of Brahma. He is creator of Brahma. So why he should not be glorified? He gives 9 reasons here in this world, verse, for Krishna to be glorified. He should be offered obeisances. Number one is that he is greater than Brahma, because he is the creator of Brahma. Brahma appears on the lotus stem, which emanates, comes out from the navel of Garbhodakshay Vishnu. That is where Lord Brahma appears. And then after Lord Brahma appears, he does not know what to do. That's all is described in the second canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. But he hears a sound, tapa, tapa, to do tapasya. So he has some intelligence. So he starts meditating on that sound which came, on his creator. And finally Krishna appears, and then he gives Brahma the power to create. And what he should, Brahma asks, what should I do? So then Krishna gives the ability, he blesses him, and he gives the power to create. And then Brahma creates. So Brahma is the creator, but Krishna himself is the maintainer. He takes the role of maintenance. And then for destruction, he gives that power to Lord Shiva to do that. But the maintenance is the big thing. Anything to create and destroy is not that difficult. But to maintain is very difficult. Even our own house, we ask someone to create, right? We hire an architect and builders to create. As it becomes old, then also we can hire someone to destroy. But we maintain ourselves. The maintenance part we do ourselves. We take care of cleaning, we take care of everything, where to keep what, we take care of the house, we maintain. Similarly, Krishna gives that power to create and destroy to Lord Brahma and Lord Shiva, but to maintain he does himself. Because maintenance is not an easy task. It's very difficult. Any society, this temple, anything to build is very easy. Of course, it's not that easy, there are difficulties. But then to maintain and continue year after year is a big challenge. Have a group of association of devotees. To maintain that group, maintain this program year after year is a lot of work, very difficult. So Krishna does that himself, the task of maintenance. ही इज ग्रेटर देन ब्रह्मा अपि आदिकर्त्रे ही इज नॉट ओनली द क्रिएटर ऑफ ब्रह्मा बट ही इज द ओरिजिनल क्रिएटर ऑफ एवरीथिंग आदि कर्त्रे आदि मीन्स द ओरिजिनल क्रिएटर कर्त्रे ही नॉट ओनली क्रिएटेड ब्रह्मा बट ही क्रिएटेड एवरीथिंग कृष्णा इज द ओरिजिनल क्रिएटर अहम सर्वस्व प्रभव मत्ता सर्वं प्रवर्तते एवरीथिंग एमिनेट्स फ्रॉम मी एवरीथिंग मीन्स एवरीथिंग एवरीथिंग देर इज नथिंग दैट इज दैट एग्जिस्ट सेपरेट फ्रॉम कृष्णा देर इज नथिंग सो आदिकर्त्रे ही इज द ओरिजिनल क्रिएटर ऑफ एवरीथिंग नॉट ओनली ब्रह्मा बट द होल यूनिवर्स द होल यूनिवर्सेस सो मेनी यूनिवर्सेस आर देयर ही इज देयर क्रिएटर and all the elements that exist all the living entities that are there we tiny living entities he is the creator we come from him mama evansho jivaloke jivabhuta sanatana he is the original creator so a person of that greatness why he should not be glorified why should he not be glorified why gentle people or saintly persons should not glorify krishna that is what arjuna is saying It is a natural to glorify. Even in this world, if we find, suppose, somebody who can create palaces, make big buildings, and do some wonderful things, people will glorify him. Many people will offer pranam. Now, if say Prime Minister just comes here, suppose, many people will go and offer pranam to him. But what has he done? Not much. He just. Prime Minister for one country for some period and that's all. He will do some things in this years, but Krishna has been doing this for immemorial. And not only one small place, the whole universes after universes, and everything in there he does. And he will continue to do so in the future also. Then why she should not be offered obeisances? Why we should not offer obeisances to Krishna? If someone has even little bit intelligence, he should offer pranam to Krishna, should bow down to Krishna. We all exist because of him. He has provided everything that we need, the air, the water, the food to eat, the place to live, the clothes to wear. Everything is provided by Krishna. So why we should not offer pranam to him? So it's very naturally saying that it's very normal. They must offer. Then he says, Ananta. Krishna is Ananta. Anta means which has an end. Krishna is Ananta, has no end. It's no beginning, no end. There is no limit to anything that Krishna has. His number of devotees, the amount of opulence, the number of universes, his reach. To any place, everything is unlimited. We cannot even fathom, we cannot even count how many opulences Krishna has, to what degree. It's all beyond our ability, beyond how much we can glorify. We are very, very tiny, very insignificant. He's Ananta, unlimited, and He only is Ananta. There is no one else, everyone else is finite. All great leaders, great personalities, they are all finite. They have limits. It's only Krishna who is unlimited and his expansions, his incarnations. He is Ananta. So he should be glorified. Devesh. Devesh means Deva and Ish. So who is Lord of the Devatas is Devesh. Even the demigods are glorified. People offer pranams to demigods, to sun god, the moon, to Indra, Lord Ganesh, Lord Brahma, Lord Shiva, to all these great demigods. People offer obeisances. They are very powerful. But Krishna is the Lord of all of them. Devesh is the lord of all the demigods. So he must be offered obeisances. He must be glorified. It's very natural. Jagannivas, he is the resting place of the whole universe. Everything Krishna not only created this universe, but also he has provided a shelter for this universe. The whole universe is resting in his energy. He, because of him, everything is in place. One thing is to create, but another thing to set everything in motion and let it exist like that. It's a different thing. Like one can create, I can create a few balls, suppose. But to make a solar system where everything is rotating nicely, perfectly, for so many years, that's altogether a much more complex thing. But Krishna does this effortlessly, without any effort. The sun, moon, stars, planets, they are all perfectly revolving, rotating. He is the resting place for the universes, he is the resting place for all the living entities. Ultimately, when the whole universe is destroyed, then everything goes back and rests in him only. He only provides that shelter. So actually, these verses are telling us that there is nothing other than Krishna. There is nothing. There is no existence other than him. Everything we have, we do is all by his mercy only. We live under his grace. Whether we recognize it or we don't recognize it, which most of the people don't recognize it, but we live under his grace only, all the time. Our existence is all his grace. Jagannivas, Tvam Aksharam. And then, after that, Arjuna is saying that, okay, you created this universe, you created all living entities, everything, but everything will be finished one day. Ksharam, which will be destroyed. But you are Aksharam, you will not be destroyed. You are indestructible. It means Krishna will exist whether this universe exists or does not exist. Krishna continues to exist. He is Aksharam. His existence is eternal. It's always there. And it's only his existence is eternal. Then Sat Asat Tat Paramyat is the cause of all causes and transcendental to this material manifestation. Tat Param, beyond all causes. In this world we have so many causes. We have I may be the cause of something, but there are others who are cause of me, and this way the chain goes on. Someone is cause of something. Someone has created this desk. He is the cause of this desk. But if we trace it back, where does this desk come from? Oh, he created. But where did the ingredients come from? The tree. Who created the tree? Where does tree come from? Tree come from Mother Earth. And air, water, all these ingredients. Who created all those things? If we keep on questioning, ultimately we go back to Krishna. Ultimately we have to go back to Krishna. Because no one has ability to create anything on one's own. Nowadays, scientists and technology creates so many things, but who provides the ingredients? Nature. Microphone is there, but where all this is coming from? All the ingredients are coming from plants, the trees and rocks, so many things. Ultimately, all the ingredients are coming from nature, and nature is coming from Krishna. Maya dakshena prakriti suyate sacharachara. So everything ultimately comes from Krishna. No one can produce a microphone out of thin air. They want to produce one microphone is there. No one can do like that. Now I want a house. Someone just meditates and something just manifests house automatically. No one can do that. One will get the bricks, cement, whatever, everything comes from nature. So there may be so many causes here in this world, and people, if someone creates something nice, people glorify that person. Oh, that person created this wonderful thing. A new phone, a new building. People glorify, but people don't glorify who is providing all these things, all the ingredients, and also the intelligence to create this is coming from Krishna. Krishna is providing the ingredients also. Krishna is giving the intelligence also, but he is not glorified. So real devotees who are perfected beings, who are elevated, those who understand, they glorify Krishna. Because they see that ultimately Krishna is the source of everything. All other sources, everything else comes after Krishna only. So Krishna is offered obeisances by all great personalities because he has that quality to attract everyone. All these great personalities, they become attracted to Krishna, and naturally they offer. Krishna is not forcing people that you come and you must offer pranam to me. He's not doing that. But devotees like to offer because they are naturally attracted to him. We know this pastime of Shukadeva Goswami. And when Vishnu Vyasadeva compiled Srimad Bhagavatam, he wanted to teach. He wanted someone who can understand this. So he prayed and then finally received Shukadeva Goswami as his son. But as soon as he is born, he left for the forest. Then Shri Vyasadeva is very much concerned. He started running behind him to bring him back, but he did not come back. Then he returned disappointed and then was thinking what to do. And then he sent two of his disciples and have them memorize two shlokas from Srimad Bhagavatam, which describe the qualities of Krishna. One is how he is merciful, and one how beautiful he is. One shloka describing his mercy and another shloka describing his beauty. And he sent them, you go and chant these shlokas in the forest where Shukadeva Goswami is. So when they went and started chanting those shlokas repeatedly, Shukadeva Goswami, once he hears the shlokas, he became very attracted. And he comes, yes, yes, what are you chanting? Chant again. Where did you learn? He says, see, see, our Guru Maharaj taught. Who is your Guru Maharaj? Vyasadeva taught. Huh? Yeah. And then he comes back to hear those shlokas. Because what happened? He got attracted by hearing the qualities of Krishna and the beauty of Krishna. They didn't force Shukadeva Goswami to come back and hear Srimad Bhagavatam. He got pulled. He got attracted. So when devotees, they become the devotees and other persons, when they become purified, they become attracted to Krishna. They become attracted. And then they naturally offer pranams. In Srimad Bhagavatam, we see how many times devotees have offered obeisances. So many prayers are there. Prayers of Kumarani Kunti, first shloka, Namaste Purusham Tvadyam, Ishvara Prakrite Param, Alaksham Sarva Bhutanam Antarbahira Avasthitam. So many prayers, Bhishma Dev's prayers, Uttara's prayers, Kunti Maharani's prayers, Prachetas are there, Narad Muni, Yudhishthira Maharaj, so many prayers, prayers of Rudra, prayers and prayers and prayers of Lord Brahma. Whole Srimad Bhagavatam is filled with prayers where they are all offering obeisances to Krishna. All great personalities. Because they are so much attracted. When we are attracted to someone, then naturally there is a lot of respect and love, and one likes to glorify. It's very natural. It's a natural state of consciousness where one feels attracted to glorify Krishna. And that is the most happy state, blissful state of a living entity, when the living entity naturally feels like glorifying Krishna. Not by force, that, oh, I have to today give a Bhagavad Gita class, so I have to glorify Krishna. Or I have to speak to some other person, so I glorify Krishna. Rather, when one attains that level of consciousness, and one feels blissful in glorifying Krishna, then that is a very happy state. That is the perfection of a living entity, when one glorifies Krishna. And that glorification is filled with bliss. And he is the only one who should actually be glorified, who deserves glorification. And all his pure devotees who are fully surrendered to him, they should be glorified. So that's what Arjuna is saying here today in this verse, that why then should they not offer their respectful obeisances unto you? Because you are the shelter of the universe, you are God of gods, you are unlimited, and you are the invincible source, the cause of all causes, transcendental to this material manifestation. And you are greater than even Brahma. You are his creator, you are the original creator. All these regions he gives, you need to be glorified. So, for us, we should reflect on this and pray that when that day will come, when we will feel like glorifying Krishna like this, naturally, instead of glorifying so many things in this world, we are attracted by so many things and we glorify so many things in this world. But when we become attracted to Krishna and we want to glorify him, that's natural feeling comes, then we are making progress on the real path. And that is our perfection. So with this we end here. Thank you very much. Anyone has any comments or questions? Okay, want to say? Shri Prabhupada ki, Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki, Thai Gau Premanande, Hare Krishna. Yes, ma'am. Okay. Sambandha, Abhidheya and Prayojan, these are the three aspects of our devotional service. First, for a new devotee, we do not know what is our relationship with Krishna. First, we don't even know who we are. We don't even know that we are different from this body. Where did we come from? But when we get to know these basic things, that actually we are not this body, that is the most basic knowledge in a spiritual life. And then the next thing to understand is, we are a spirit soul, then where did we come from? What is our source? And then we come to know our source is Krishna. So we have a relationship with Krishna. This understanding is called Sambandha Gyan. This understanding that we are part and parcel of Krishna. We have a relationship with Krishna. Of course, the other relationship which is, which rasa it is in, whether sakya, dasya, that's a very high state. We don't have to worry about that in the beginning stages. It suffices for us to understand that we all have a relationship with Krishna. We are all part and parcel of Krishna. Krishna is our Lord and Master, and we are his servant. If we understand this much, at least that is sufficient for us to start on the path of bhakti. If we don't understand this, we cannot do bhakti. We are Jivara Swarupahai Krishnara Nityadas. We are all servants of Krishna. This is the most basic understanding. This is called sambandha. Sambandha meaning means relationship. The English word for sambandha is relationship. So our relationship with Krishna is that we are the servant and he is the master. He is my Lord. This is called sambandha gyan. Once we understand this, then simply understanding is not enough. We have to act according to that relationship. Just like for a mother and a child, mother just says that, oh, he is my son, and but doesn't do anything, doesn't take care of the child, doesn't feed him, doesn't make arrangements for child's education, doesn't provide any health care, then what is that relationship? If there is a relationship, then there has to be activities based on that relationship. Right? If I say I am father of so and so, means as if then I have some duty as a father. Similarly, when we understand that I am servant of Krishna, it means I have some duty as a servant I have to do. Then only I can claim that I am servant of Krishna. Simply saying I am servant of Krishna, but I don't do anything for Krishna, what kind of servant I am? So then understanding what should I do as a servant for Krishna, that is called avidheya. Avidheya. Understanding of what should I do as a servant. And all that is given in Srimad Bhagavad Gita. Krishna says, yat karoshi, yadashnashi, yat juhoshi, dadashiyat, yat tapasyasi kaunteya, tat kurushyama darpanam. Whatever you do, whatever you offer, whatever austerities you perform, you do it as an offering to me. Patram pushpam phalam toyam yome bhakta prayakshati. The flower, water, all these things you offer to me in devotion, I will accept it. So Krishna is giving instructions what we should do as a servant. Man mana bhava mad bhakto madhyaji mam namaskuru. You offer obeisances to me. You think about me, always remember me. All these things Krishna is telling. So understanding all these things and practicing devotional service, that is all part of avidheya. So our whole life actually should be avidheya. When we become devotees, then we do this practice, attending Mangal Arati, chanting 16 rounds, taking prasadam, hearing Srimad Bhagavad Gita, serving devotees, hearing Krishna Katha. All this is part of avidheya. And the result of all this will be attainment of pure love of Krishna. That is our goal, that is called prayojan. Prayojan. Prayojan means goal. So by doing this, we will attain the goal of life and we will come to the natural state of being a servant of Krishna in love. Our relationship with Krishna is actually a relationship of love. So that initially when we start sambandha gyan, we don't have love for Krishna. We simply start with the understanding that I am a servant of Krishna. When we practice this process, slowly and slowly, this love will develop and attain that perfection where we actually live our life in pure love with Krishna. That is our perfection. That is called prayojan. So those are these three things in summary. More details, they have been described in Chaitanya Charitamrit. Thank you, Mataji. Hare Krishna. Yeah. So Prabhuji is saying that whenever we do something and it comes out nice, we should not take the credit. We should give the credit back to Krishna, because he only is giving the intelligence to do something. So this is a nice attitude to have, that helps us live in our relationship with Krishna. Always give all the credit to him. Thank you both. Hare Krishna.